Before we continue, I want to give some reassurances to anybody that's worried about the integrity of the data. What we just discussed last sounded a lot like we're throwing away data. And some of you may have noticed, hey, hold on a second, this sounds a lot like this is some kind of a lossy compression algorithm. It is a lossy compression algorithm. And we're proud of the fact that we are one of those amazingly successful, you know, lossy algorithms right alongside of the MP3 standard and the JPEG standard, in which, you know, some very reasonable decisions are made to throw away a certain amount of data in order to optimize. Now, that's what this data compression algorithm is all about. It's worked for the last 30 years very successfully. It's industry accepted. All the state agencies, the EPA, all the regulatory agencies are well aware of it. You don't have to worry that we're throwing away your data. Okay, so let's take a look at this amazingly successful compression algorithm. It's not ours. We'll give credit where credit's due. But we will go through that, and just please be reassured that you're not losing data by its very nature. Now, you may be losing data if you've configured your tags improperly, and that's why we go through this in such detail. So the data in Pi comes in this kind of a path right here. New values are brought in typically by interfaces, and on the interface, typically, we do something we call an exception test. Okay, that exception test results in data that goes into what we call the snapshot. That was the structure that feeds process book in real time, that we saw just a second ago. Now, from there, the compression test is applied next. And the compression test, the results of that compression test are stored in the Pi archives. So we like to describe this as, you know, this test right here, the exception test, is essentially a way to filter out line noise. And then the second test here, the compression test, is a way to optimize how we store this on disk so that we simply store the peaks and valleys. You know, if there's something that's on a vector that's constant, it keeps increasing, but it's at a constant rate. There's no point to keep storing a value over and over and over again. It's better to just store the peaks and valleys. So we start now with the exception test. The exception test works something like this. We take raw data, and we don't bring it all in. We just bring in those values that go outside a certain deadband. Now, if we didn't do this, then what you would see is something that looks just like this. And as you can see in this simple trend, things like these are just very minor things like line noise, really. And these are probably things that even process book can ignore. Maybe not this, maybe that's a big enough change, but just the little line noise that you see along the way, you know, this line noise is probably something that you can ignore. So that's one of the things that exception test is going to do. It's going to remove those values. Now, how this works is, let's say this is the last value that's come into the system. We're going to add to that last value and subtract from that last value an attribute we call the exception deviation. Now, that is an attribute that's built for each and every point, or specified for each and every point. Now, that exception deviation is something that if we go into the point builder, we'll see that it's just simply an attribute. It's listed right here under the archive heading. So it is something that is set on a point-by-point basis. And good news, for those of you who don't want to do any of this test, you can just set that to zero, and that essentially turns the test off. There's a couple of other settings. You set the xmax to zero and the xdev to zero. That will essentially turn this off. So the exception maximum is a time measured in seconds that would indicate that if no values go outside this deadband within that maximum time, then we will bring in a value simply because, well, we would like to keep the value updated once every xmax number of seconds. So there's two things going on. The xmax, if it expires, then we bring in a value. And the second thing would be this deviation sets this essentially a deadband. And if a value goes outside the deadband, like you see right here, you know, this value is now outside the deadband, that indicates that there's been an exception deviation. And so what we do is we actually bring in the previous value. So that's the value that goes outside the deadband. We bring in the previous value. we also bring in the value that goes outside the deadband. And of course, the reason we do that is because if we simply brought in the value itself that violates the deadband, we draw a straight line from here, point A to point D. But by bringing in both the value and the previous value, we draw a more accurate line. Now, here's a great sequence to explain this, why we bring in the value and the previous value. As you can see, as each new value comes in, they're all within that deadband that's set by the exception deviation. When a value goes outside that deadband, then of course we don't want to just bring in the connect a line here to here. Instead, what we would like to do is have a value extend to the previous value and then the value that has broken that deadband. So let's take a look at an extended example. Let's say this is our first value. It is marked E for exception. And when we bring in that value, that establishes, along with the exception deviation and the exception maximum, what that rectangle is. So we're looking for any values that go outside that or after the exception maximum time. As you can see, these values that come in that do not force an exception, they simply result in the previous values being discarded. Now at this point, we do have a value that goes outside the exception maximum time, so we bring in both that value and the previous value. We're marking E for exception and P for previous here. Now at this point, we'll go ahead and start the whole thing over again as we draw a new rectangle based on that exception deviation and the value that last passed the exception test. At this point, we do have a value that goes outside the deadband, so that value plus the previous value are brought into the system. So you can see this is the value that triggers the exception test, and this is the previous value. We'll go ahead and continue on, drawing a new rectangle there. Now this value, of course, is very obviously outside the exception deviation, so that is an exception. The system's smart enough not to bring in that value twice. It's already been brought in once as its own exception. We just continue to move this forward, eliminating those values that go outside or that don't go outside the deadband. Here we have an exception. This is the previous one. And now we get one exception after another. So all these values are going to make it into the system. There we go. Another value past the exception deviation. And we bring in that plus the previous value. So this is the end result. When those values are passed through the exception test, those values are sent to the Pi server as what we call the snapshot. Now just a note, not all interfaces do support this exception test. You're going to have to check your interface documentation. The vast majority do support the exception test. But as I mentioned before, it can be turned off if you prefer.